The Lord be with you. Friends, I am Pastor Bart Rausch, one of the pastors at Madison Square Presbyterian Church, and so glad that you can join us for our online worship this morning. We have a few announcements for the life of the church. Today, we will celebrate communion. So if you have not prepared your elements ahead of time in your worship space at home, I invite you at some point to go ahead and grab some bread and juice or whatever is close enough to bread and juice so that you may join us in communion later on in the worship service. I also want to remind you that we are forming what I'm currently calling or what we're currently calling a racial reconciliation and justice team. I've heard from a number of you already you would like to join this team. This is an effort that to make sure that we are consistent and long-term in our education and our advocacy for racial reconciliation in the world. It will require commitment and intentionality. And so I need help to make sure that I'm held accountable and that we as a church are held accountable. Just a reminder, as I did last week, that I want to give you an update on where we are in terms of thinking about coming back in person in the sanctuary to worship. We have put together a re-entry team to consider all kinds of information from denominational and other ecclesiastical sources, from health sources and governmental sources. You see the names there, Ed Blanton, Fred Campbell, Linda Nance, Phil Zamora, and Pastor Jen and I. And then we compile that information and give that information to session for them to discern how that, when we might rejoin together in person in the sanctuary. Every indication right now that we have is that there's still a lot we don't know. And so session unanimously decided that we will remain exclusively online for our worship through the end of August at the least. And that as we have more information and as we know more, we will communicate that to you. Also, want to let you know today, we're very hopeful that we will get to share our choir with you virtually for the first time. Paul and the choir members and Paul have put a lot of effort into trying to sing their parts separately and then join them all together in a virtual way for virtual choir. And so, we think it's going to work, and we hope it's the first of many to come. So we look forward to that to help us worship. And now I invite you to take a moment to take a breath, to be fully present, and let us prepare to worship God.
Esta es la fuente de identidad. This is the font of identity.
Esta es la mesa de sustento. This is the table of sustenance.
Esta es el libro de memoria y esperanza. This is the book of memory and hope.
Bienvenidos, children of God. Welcome home.
Please join me in the call to worship. Come to worship, people of God, with praise on your lips.
Even when we are feeling isolated and fearful, we can glorify the one who holds our hands in our loneliness.
Come into the presence of the one who makes holy every place, every space, holy and sacred.
Even where we continue to stay safe in our homes, the doors of grace are flung wide open for us.
Come and hear the stories of the one who loves you.
In living rooms, on laptops and devices, we will sing our songs and tell those tales of the peace and of the hope which is ours.
Please join me in the prayer of confession. Holy, holy, holy God, we know you are the sovereign of all, yet we follow false idols of market trends and poll numbers for assurance. We turn to worldly signs in these grim times. Our anxiety and anger and despair all rise and fall, and yet you are our Lord, our sovereign, the one who reigns forever in our hearts. Call us by name, remind us of your enduring, steadfast love. Breathe assurance into our hearts and minds, and help us to trust in your wisdom that prevails over all. Jesus reminds us, remember, I am with you always until the end of the age. Christ is with us now and always. The Holy Spirit is in our midst now and always. God the Creator is creating something new now and always.
We are always loved, always forgiven, always known to God and cannot be forgotten. Amen. Friends, we invite you to share the peace with one another and those that you love. If you are with folks physically, you, of course, can share peace with them. If you are physically by yourself at this moment, then I invite you to text or message or email a friend or a loved one to pass the peace of Christ to one another. May the peace of Christ be with you. For those young and young at heart, I invite you to gather in maybe a little closer to the screen or to snuggle in next to someone if you're with them. I want to share with you a book. It's called Maybe, a story about the endless potential in all of us. It is written by Kobe Yamamata. It's illustrated by Gabriella Baruch. Have you ever wondered why you're here? You are the only you there ever has been or ever will be. You have so much to offer. Maybe you will invent something that no one has ever seen before. Maybe you will build things that reach high into the sky. Your life is yours. Try as many things as you can try. See as much as you can see. Wherever you go, take your hopes, pack your dreams, and never forget, it is on journeys that discoveries are made. Maybe you will help others to see the beauty in each day. Or maybe you will lift cheering crowds onto their feet. Do everything with love. Follow your heart and see where it leads you. Maybe you're here to shine a light into places that have been dark for far too long. Maybe you will speak up for those who can't speak for themselves. Maybe you are here to help in ways that only you can. There will be struggles, there will be fears, and it won't always be easy. At times, it will feel really hard. And you might make a mess of things. You may fall down. You may fail. But you will also get back up and you will rise a little stronger and a little taller because there really is more inside you than you know. And this world needs your gifts, your talents, your big ideas. And maybe you're just getting started. What if you're only scratching the surface of what you can do and what you can be? What if you have talents you haven't discovered yet? There's something powerful, even magical, about you. You already have everything it takes to do big things. Maybe you have no idea just how good you really can be. And maybe you don't know how much you matter. But maybe, just maybe, the world has been waiting centuries for someone exactly like you. One thing is for sure, you are here. And because you are here, anything is possible. So friends, I want to encourage you to explore your maybes, to find your gifts, to find those talents, to find those things only you can do. You were made special by God to do what it was exactly that you are meant to do. You may not know yet what that is, and it might be a whole host of different things. But I encourage you to know that you are a child of God. You are special. You are loved. You are talented. You are needed. Amen. And let us continue in prayer. Hold on one moment. Let us continue in prayer as we pray for the assurance of and inspiration of God's Spirit. Living God, help us so to hear your holy word that we may truly understand, that understanding we may believe, and believing we may follow in all faithfulness and obedience, seeking your honor and glory in all that we do. Through Christ our Lord. Amen. I'd like to share with you the scripture today. It comes from Matthew's gospel, the last chapter of the gospel, chapter 28, verses 16 through 20. Listen for a word from God. Now the 11 disciples went to Galilee, to the mountain to which Jesus had directed them. When they saw him, they worshipped him, but some doubted. And Jesus came and said to them, "All authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Go, therefore, and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything that I have commanded you. And remember, I am with you always to the end of the age." Friends, we have been exploring resurrection these last six or seven. This is our seventh week as we've talked about resurrection. We have talked about resurrection as relationship, abundance, protection, love, promise, and companionship. And so what do we do with all of these things about resurrection? One of the questions that some of you ask me after I preach and that I tried to ask myself as I prepare to preach is, so what? So what do we do with these words? What do we do with this ancient text? Today, I want to close out our time thinking about resurrection. With resurrection is also calling. I read a text from the last chapter of Matthew. Perhaps for some of you, it is a familiar text, perhaps many of you. It's known as the Great Commission or Great Commission. Many of you have heard me talk about, I hope, that the church is one of those institutions that does not need to search for a mission. So many institutions, so many organizations spend time making sure that they are clear on their vision and mission, and that is good and healthy work. But as a church, we actually don't need to spend a lot of time figuring out our mission because our mission is given to us. It's given to us in two ways, through the great commandment, you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, and mind, and love your neighbor as yourself, and the great commission to go and baptize and teach people to obey the ways of Jesus. The church's mission reflects that it is the only entity that I'm aware of, the only organization that exists for the benefit of other people. The church exists for the benefit of other people. Certainly there is the call to evangelize And I know that that can be a scary word, but there is that call to evangelize, to share the good news. Evangelize simply means good news. It doesn't mean that we're to coerce someone into believing what it is that we believe, not to proselytize. But rather, I want you to think about sharing good news, like sharing something with someone when you talk about something you love, when you talk about something or someone that you love with another person. My guess is mostly you do that with enthusiasm. If you talk to me for any length of time, it is likely that at some point you will hear me talk about my wife, Kelly, or one of my children, or Madison Square. All things that I love and want to share with others. And so we're called to evangelize, to share good news, to tell people a good word. Now, I know some of you may say or be reminded of a quote from St. Francis of Assisi that goes like this, and it's one that I have quoted often or put on my Facebook page. It says this: preach the gospel at all times. When necessary, use words. Now, I really like that quote, but sometimes I think that it is used maybe a little too much from us as Presbyterians, that we would rather our actions speak louder than words. Sometimes that's a little safer for us. But my friends, let me tell you, words are also important. Words and actions together. And so when Jesus asks the disciples long ago and asks us to be a part of the co-mission of God, to go and make disciples, what does that mean? What does it mean to shape and form people in the ways of Jesus? Well, as you might imagine, Scripture has a lot to say about that. There is the fruit of the Spirit in Galatians, that is love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. We get to learn that in ourselves and teach that to one another. There's plenty to say about loving our enemy. There is care for the widow and the orphan. There's the call to give sight to the blind, to mend the brokenhearted, to give release to the captives, welcome to the stranger, to be ambassadors for reconciliation, to hold fast to one another, to recognize that we are better together than we are apart. Oh yes, and there's that call not to be haughty. I love that word. That is, there's a call not to think better of ourselves over another, but to approach people with humility, to be persistent in prayer, not to be anxious, but to be joyful, to remember to laugh, and above all else, to do everything in love. That's a lot. It's a lot, and it requires intentionality. There has been a shift in our society a few decades ago where at one point in time, the society helped support and shape people into a Christian identity. Remember, if you can, for those of you who can, remember when stores were closed on Wednesday evenings and on all day on Sundays because they knew that was when people were at church, or where it was important for someone who was in a prominent business position to make sure that they were at the right church. The society helped form Christian identity. But that has shifted. We now live in a world that has many commitments, many demands, many different things that shape and form our identity. We talk a lot, or people talk a lot about the post things, like postmodernism. Well, a couple of the other posts are we're in a post-Christian world or a post-denominational world. One person has written this: without the scaffolding of cultural Christianity to support the church, fewer and fewer church members benefit from immersion in an integrated set of communal Christian practices, beliefs, and norms. Without these communal practices, beliefs, and norms, many assemble beliefs, perspectives, and practices fluidly out of a variety of sources, some of which may be antithetical to core Christian commitments. In many respects, we are more similar to the ancient church, to the church of the first few centuries of its existence, than to the church from 50, 30, or even 20 years ago. And Matthew is interested in his community and providing guidance to that community in crisis on how it should understand its calling and mission. Matthew writes to his community to assist them in developing a missionary ethos that will match the challenges of a new time. The gospel itself is a missionary text because the gospel writer wishes to embolden the community members towards seeing opportunities for witness and service around them. I believe that we're in a challenging new time in the world, and it will call for a missionary ethos. These early Christian communities, like the one that Matthew is writing to, shared the conviction that they existed for Christ's mission, that they were the result of the apostolic mission from those disciples, and that their purpose was to continue that mission. So they understand themselves to be missionary by their very nature. While we might be in post-Christendom or post-denominational or post-church, I still think the church is important. And God has a mission that needs that church. The world needs good news. The world needs to turn to one another. The world needs reconciliation. The world needs resurrection. The world needs a committed group of people working for justice. The world needs a committed group of people who operate from an ethic of love and not from a foundation of suspicion and fear. But it just won't magically happen. Becoming a disciple doesn't just happen. Becoming a committed group of people doesn't just happen. It's a conscious choice to become a disciple. Disciples are made, not born. It is entirely possible to be a Christian, to call yourself a Christian, to even be an active church member, but not be a disciple. When Jesus called the 12 who followed him, they had to make a choice to reorder their lives. Following Jesus made serious demands on their time, their lifestyle, their commitments, and their priorities. We do not drift into discipleship. We choose discipleship. We will not drift into advocacy and justice. We will have to make that happen and be consistent and intentional, myself included. This passage tells us that becoming a disciple requires training. Becoming a disciple takes time. It takes educating yourself. Prior to this commissioning of the 11, the disciples had spent 3 years living with, working with, and learning from Jesus. Only after this time does Jesus give them the authority to teach in his name. Only after they have gained a strong knowledge and understanding of what it means to follow Jesus are they sent out to teach and share with others the good news of Christ. Friends, it will take time for us to become committed disciples. Now, I know earlier I said, don't be anxious. And maybe some of you are feeling a little anxiety. I know that I have felt anxious as I think about being more committed if I'm up to the task. But I think that's also one of the marks of what it is to be a disciple who follows Jesus. It's all a little nerve-wracking. it should give us pause. But we don't have to be perfect or full of faith all the time to be disciples. Oftentimes when I have heard people preach on this text, or even when I have preached on this text, I conveniently skip over verse 17, not paying attention to the reaction that the disciples have when Jesus comes to them on the mountain. Verse 17 says this: when they saw him, they worshiped him, but some doubted. Jesus' response to this doubt isn't to chastise the disciples, but it's to commission them into God's service and to let them know he will be with them through the end of the age. He does not give up on them. What if faithful proclamation of the good news demands the courage to acknowledge that faith isn't easy? Perhaps Matthew was counting on the fact that both preacher and hearer can, in fact, handle the truth that faith and doubt are part of the same conversation. We don't have to be perfect. We don't have to have perfect faith before we can do God's work. Think of the book maybe I just read. We will make mistakes. We'll fail. We'll fall. But we'll get back up again. Doubts and questions and mistakes do not exclude us from service to God. In fact, even though some of the disciples have doubts, the disciples have already demonstrated their faith just by showing up. The reason that they're there at the mountain in Galilee isn't because they saw the risen Lord, but they had good news shared with them. They had heard about it from the women who had seen Jesus at the tomb. They had to have faith based on the testimony of others, not their own experience, that Jesus would be at this mountain to meet them. Friends, the world needs us to show up. The world needs to hear some good news. The world needs us to be committed disciples. The world needs us to be ambassadors for reconciliation. The world needs resurrection. The world needs us. Amen. Friends, we are about to come to a time of prayer and offering. While our virtual choir sings, I invite you to text me any prayer requests that you might have, or you can also comment on the chat on Zoom or in the comments on Facebook, and I will try to gather all of those up while the song is occurring so that we may offer them to God. You also can take this time if you wish to write a check and send that in, or donate online for your offering. Let us prepare to offer all that we have to God. Thank you. Friends, let us join together in the invitation to the Lord's Supper. Jesus said, "I am the bread of life. Whoever comes to me will never be hungry, and whoever believes in me will never be thirsty." Presbyterian tradition teaches that Jesus is present with us through the act of sharing this meal.
Jesus is not bound to a specific place, specific materials, or the actions of a specific person. We believe that Christ is present with us by the Holy Spirit whenever and wherever we, the church, share this sacrament together.
So the table you are using right now is no longer your table alone. It is part of Christ's table, and you are part of Christ's church. Come, church, to the table of grace.
We come as we are with what we have. It is enough. Christ invites us to sit and eat and drink together, to remember the gift of his saving grace and our connections to one another through his wondrous love.
The Holy One be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to God.
Let us give thanks to our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
It is indeed right to give you thanks and praise, O God. We are the people of God. We are the body of Christ. We are scattered, and the body of Christ is broken. But as we gather, the body of Christ is remembered. The people of Israel were sustained by God through their years of wilderness wandering. God rained down on them manna to eat and gave them the grain of heaven. And we too are God's people, sustained by God through the wilderness of this world. God, of all those who are scattered and broken, you call us to wholeness. We thank you for the love demonstrated in giving your Son so that we might be united with you. We thank you that in Christ you enter into the pain, uncertainty, and fear of the world, and that your arms are open in loving embrace, gathering us to you as a mother hen gathers her brood under her wing, as a shepherd gathers his flock, as a father extends his arms running at full clip to welcome you home. We thank you for bread and wine, symbols and signs for us today of your faithfulness to your people through all generations. And so we will share in bread together, and we will share in wine together. On the night in which Jesus was betrayed, he gathered in an upper room with his disciples, and he took bread, and after giving thanks, blessed it and broke it and said, "This is my body broken for you." And in a similar manner, Jesus took a cup and after giving thanks, poured it out saying, "This is the cup of the new covenant sealed in my blood shed for you. Whenever you drink of this, do this in remembrance of me." Friends, these are the gifts of God for the people of God. Please take and eat and drink. And let us join together in prayer. Oh God, we thank you for this meal, for the ways in which you feed us. Change us, mold us. Let this be sustenance for our journey as we seek to be committed disciples of you. Feed us and sustain us that we might feed and sustain others in their discipleship. Let us be bearers and sharers of good news for the world. O God, on this day, we offer to you many prayers. Hear us as we pray, especially this day for Susan Shaw Meadow and her, for congratulations and for joy as she continues on the next step of her journey toward ordination. We offer prayers of healing for Atha Bell Hughes, Linda Nance's 91-year-old sister who has fluid on her lung and is seeking to recover from COVID-19. Oh God, we offer prayers for a friend's husband that is having surgery on Wednesday. We offer prayers for Becky's mom, Rosemary, who has an infection in her vertebra and disc. Oh God, we offer prayers for Justin Howell and those who knew him and know him, a Texas State student critically injured by the Austin Police Department during a protest. We offer prayers for all of those who are protesting and for those who cry out for justice. We lift up to you the youth and the young adults looking for answers. Oh God, we ask for pain relief. We lift up to you Floyd Sackett, who has moved to hospice care. We lift up to you Ed Sackett and Lynette when Lynette said yes. And so we joyfully will celebrate a wedding in the future. We lift to you Ernestine that she have good test results. We ask for prayers of safety and perseverance for White Coats for Black Lives during their rally today at 4 p.m. at UT Health Center. We offer traveling mercies for Beth, Daniel, and baby Oscar. We lift up to you a cousin, Kathy, who is dealing with cancer. For those who are locked down still in nursing homes and for families in grief who cannot see them, particularly for Jim and Mark and Ken, Teresa. We pray for Tyler as he's recovering from an injury on his hand. And for Bernard, who has two upcoming surgeries. We offer prayers for Kenny, still experiencing pain. We offer prayers for Emerald, who is feeling weak and is in pain from pregnancy. We offer prayers for Tim undergoing chemo and for Carol. Oh God, for all of those prayers that we have voiced out loud and for those that remain in our heart, we pray. And we continue in our prayers as we pray the prayer which you taught us to say together, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Friends, I invite you to join me in the benediction. Created and called to be faithful stewards, we are sent forth by our God.
We will take all that is good to places of brokenness, all that is beautiful to those who live in despair.
Called and commissioned to be faithful disciples, we are sent forth by Jesus, word of hope.
We follow Jesus to every place he would lead us, to every person who will bless us.
Called and filled with the very breath of peace, we are sent forth by the Spirit, God's grace.
We will join the Spirit in bringing life where there is fear, in offering love where hate seeks to take hold.
And now may the peace of creation's imagination, the peace of grace's word, the peace of hope's spirit, and the deep, deep peace of God and community, holy in one, be with you this day and for always. Amen. God is for you. Go in peace and serve the Lord.